perfect game going into the bottom of the seventh inning. You're down 4-0. You are leading off. And again, you said you don't remember what happened. I don't even remember what the count was at this point.
Yeah.
But you know that it takes one, right? The pitcher at this point probably knows I'm perfect through six.
Yeah. Right?
18 up, 18 down. In your mind, forget about what you remember about the game. Do you feel like if I can just get aboard in any way, maybe it mentally takes him out? It's such a psychological game.
Yeah.
He knows he's perfect. He knows they're nine outs away from going to the finals. Do you think if I can just get on in any way possible?
Yeah, hit by pitch, walk, hit, whatever. Obviously, hits weren't really working for us. So I was like, I'm leading off this inning as a leadoff guy myself. That's my job. Like, I got to get something going. And I think my approach was, I think I had a line drive to right and then a ground ball to second. So Pike obviously knows, like, what I'm trying to do. So he's pounding in fastballs. So I was kind of open up my zone a little bit, change my approach, and be ready for that inside fastball, especially if I was in a plus count.
Yep.
I knew he was going to try and, you know, attack that spot instead of giving me a pitch over the plate that I can do something with, because that's my game.
Sure.
That's my approach. So as a pitcher, you have to attack hitters' approaches that you know, and I think throughout the league, people know to, like, throw me hard in. Mm-hmm. So I kind of opened up a little bit and, you know, see if I could do some pull ball or whatever and just be ready for that fastball.
I believe it's either the first pitch or second pitch, and I set the whole thing up here. I talk about Don Larson's perfect game in 1956, and as I start to say Roy Halladay, because he's the only other pitcher to throw, he threw a no-hitter in the playoffs, this is what winds up happening. So we can roll it from here. And so
Jordan Jess got us fired up, I think, so we'll give him all the credit.
So it's the fourth pitch, so it's a 2-1.
2-1 count, so I'm looking for fastball. This guy's got everything going. No one's getting hit, so he's going to go fastball here. He's not going to play around and try and walk me. So I'm thinking fastball in here because that's what he was trying to do. Yep, sure enough. Got enough of it. Got enough of it. But that's what I was sitting on. That was my approach. I knew he was going to come in.
Do you think when something like this happens, it gives other guys confidence or takes the pressure off everybody else now? Everybody's trying to get that hit.
Oh, for sure, yeah. I mean, if a guy hadn't given up a hit all day and someone got a hit, you're like, oh, I can do that now. And here we are. He's falling behind in counts. 2-0 fastball. So he's going to make us earn it, first of all. He's not going to throw a curveball there 2-0 and go 3-0 on Lang. So he's coming fastball. Lang was sitting dead red.
Brady at this point in the series is 0-9, right? You could probably take any nine stretch at bat during the course of the season, and you probably find it tough to find one or two stretches where he went 0-9. But he's 0-9 at this point on a 1-1 count.
Yep.
And I think this gets everybody going. The hit helps. Lang gets it going. But this is the guy that everyone turns to.
See you, ball.
The left. Well hit. Way back.
Try going in with fastball.
And this one is gone.
Brady doesn't make many mistakes when a ball is put in his wheelhouse.
And this is the guy that, after you guys were two hit by Winnipeg, calls the team meeting, the players only meeting, and you wind up going 17-3 down the stretch.
Yeah, veteran presence on the team, Brady. Been around, you know, a lot of baseball games and a lot of different players and leagues and. Someone I looked up to as a hitter for sure. Like, there's so many times in the dugout, like, he'd go 4-for-4 or whatever, and just casual day for Brady. Everyone'd be like, God, he's the best hitter in the world. Like, guy doesn't strike out, he walks.
And his demeanor never changes.
Smile. Just even keel.
here's
he's terrifying to face, probably, as a pitcher.
Here's the interesting thing, too. Like, it happened so quickly that they didn't have an opportunity, perhaps, to get anyone loose and warm in the bullpen.
Yeah.
And so Pike, to his credit, able to come back, gets the next two hitters. But Josh Allen, who is as good a six hitter as there is in this league, the guy has more power than you would think by looking at him.
Yeah.
And he's one of those guys that
he's
gets
strong.
Fired up. Yeah.
Josh is strong. What, 2-0 count? So falling behind again. Josh is sitting fastball, only fastball. And he's swinging regardless and just hammers
right
it. That's
field,
just pure brute strength
hit,
right there. Like,
way back,
out of the stadium. I don't even think there was much wind.
No. I mean, he goes just opposite field at that point.
Yeah, a flick of the wrist. Like, I mean, how many bombs did Josh have this year? Like close 18 or something
like
that?
Yeah, he had 17 home runs 17 in the regular bombs, season, like, yeah.
And they're all just missiles. Yeah, tie the ball game up. Now we know we're in
it. You talk about picking yourself up off the mat.
Now we go.
Yeah, the demeanor from the beginning of that inning, there's a principal owner, Marv Goldklang, right there. but the demeanor from the beginning of this inning to the end of this half inning.
Yeah.
What's it like? Take me inside that dugout.
I mean, it's a 0-0 ball game now, essentially. So we got the crowd behind us. And we're finally, you know, obviously we know the pitcher, Pike won't be in much longer. Just because of this momentum, they're trying to stop that. But yeah, it's playoff baseball. Like one swing of the bat, you can just be back in it. It's crazy.